everybody. Thanks for coming out. Really appreciate it. This is the fourth installment of our 5-session course for Solidity Contract Development for Ethereum. This time we will go more in depth on Solidity, do a little bit of voting. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Gerald Nash. I'm a freshman computer science major at Howard University. You can find me anywhere on the internet with this username, Onyx. That's how it's pronounced. It's not how it's spelled. Today's game plan, we're going to run through our last session's voting contract and sort of discuss how we can make it better if we can. And then we're going to review the data types, the Solidity data types that we went over last time. Quiz you guys on what you remember, what you don't. Then we're going to learn one more data type that's very popular and very powerful that I really want you guys to know. We're going to go over secret fields, so secret functions and variables and stuff like that in Solidity. Then we're going to sort of make a few changes to our voting contract together. Today's suggested tools are Remix again. It's an IDE or integrated development environment, so it has a bunch of tools that help you with your smart contract development. You can find Remix at remix.ethereum.org. And I also recommend going to ethfiddle.com. I just found that before the last session and found out that it lets you deploy your contracts to a blockchain on your local computer, which is pretty helpful when you're trying to interact with your contracts and test them out. Just your friendly neighborhood browser. So any browser that you have on your computer should work properly, because I'll give you guys a link at the end and we'll go over editing our voting contract together. So last time, all we did is build a simple voting contract, right? Then we went over some pretty simple data types. So let me know if I'm going too fast again. Here's our voting contract. We have our constructor function. We can calculate how many votes a certain voting candidate has. We can vote for a certain candidate, and we can get the name of any candidate. And if you have any questions, feel free to interrupt me. I'd like to keep it an open discussion and stuff like that. And we also did some data types. So, who was here? Was anybody here last time? Okay, two people. Does anybody, or if you weren't here, did you watch the footage on YouTube? Raise your hand if you did.
No.
Okay. Cool. That's okay. So for those of you who were here or did watch the footage, do you remember what an integer does or what kind of data it stores?
Whole numbers?
That's correct. So yeah, integers specified by the keyword int or int represent whole numbers. And examples can be things like 1, 2, negative 7, 25, any whole numbers you can think of, positive or negative or 0. And you can sort of picture it as a number line where any of these vertical takes on the number line are whole numbers and they're therefore integers. Anybody remember what a Boolean is? What kind of data it stores?
Binary
data, that's correct. So Booleans with the keyword bool in Solidity represent binary options. So on, off, true, false, yes or no, 0, 1, all that kind of stuff. And the types of values that it can take are true or false. And so you can visualize it as a on, off switch. So on is equal to true and off is equal to false. Anybody remember what unsigned integers are? It's a bit tricky, this one. No? Okay, cool. Well, an unsigned integer specified by the Solidity keyword uint represents 0 and all positive numbers. So in the same way how a normal integer can do all positive or most positive numbers, 0 and then negative numbers, an unsigned integer can only do 0 and then all positive numbers. And again, you can visualize it as a number line starting from 0 and going all the way out to the positive. Any questions? Anybody know anything about addresses? What kind of data it stores? Kind of self-explanatory. Okay, well, addresses store Ethereum addresses. So the same way how when you generate a wallet, you're given an address that somebody can use to send you Ether. Solidity has a data type that lets you store addresses really anywhere in the Ethereum blockchain. So examples are like the zero address or any arbitrary address that anybody has. And it can be a human address or a contract address. They're all the same. Anybody remember what kind of data a string stores?
Characters.
That's correct, a string of characters. So a string, specified by the solidity keyword string, represents strings of text. So just sort of arrays of text or vectors of text. So an example of any kind of string could be like foot, your name, my name, the quick brown fox jumped over the lazy dog, anything like that. How about 32 byte chunks? This gets tricky too. Anybody else remember this? No? Cool. But yeah, 32 byte chunks represented by the solidity keyword bytes32 represent a chunk of 32 bytes. So for those of you who don't know, a byte is 8 bits, and a bit is the simplest form of information in that computers operate with. So if a bit can be a 0 or a 1, a byte can be a 0, 1, or any combination of those, as long as there's 8 together. So 8 bits is equal to a byte. And this bytes32 can store 32 of those bytes. And they represent sort of any kind of data. Again, I didn't really specify whether it's a number or a character or a string. So bytes32 can really store any kind of data that fits within 32 bytes. Any questions? What's up? That's a good question. So in traditional computer science, because an address is just 0x followed by a few of these characters, this would be considered a number, but when it comes to solidity in Ethereum, an address has its own data type. So an address is literally stored in a variable of type address.
Hey, Jill, are each of those spaces, are they hex? In other words, 16 different characters can be? So you see where the C is it 0 through 9,
it
and
is.
Then capital A through F, and then capitals?
Yeah, it is an X number. That's correct. So for those of you who didn't understand that, he was asking if this address was a hex number. And so if we count day to day from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, from 1 to 10, that's decimal because there are 10 possible combinations, 0 through 9, for one digit. Now, when it comes to computers, there are different ways to count, different counting systems. And so, what he was talking about, hexadecimal, if decimal has 10 possible numbers per one digit, hexadecimal has 16, so 0 through 15. And so, it gets kind of weird because there are only 10 numbers, 0 through 9, right? So, to represent 11 up to 15, we go from A through F. And so, C, I don't really know it that well, but I believe C is like 13 or something like that. So yeah, this is just a way to represent a number in most computer science courses and most computer programming languages. Cool. Any other questions while we're here? Does anybody remember what a map is? No? Okay, cool. Yeah, this is pretty complicated too. So with a map, it's basically a key value store. So it has a weird sort of keyword syntax as well. So the syntax is you have the keyword mapping followed by an opening and a close parenthesis. And you have a type followed by a fat arrow and then a type. The first type is the type that your keys will be. And the second type is the type that your values will be. And so that sounds kind of weird, but you can think of it as a two-column table where one column are your keys and the other column are your values, and you can only search in the key column. So if I have a map that maps English words to Spanish words, I have my keys that are English words, and my values are Spanish words. So if I'm searching through my keys, I can search these keys and say I'm on banana, right? So to find the value, I just go through the same row and I find the word plátano. So now I know that the word banana is an English word that maps to a Spanish word, plátano. Does that make sense? Cool. So yeah, that's cool and everything, but that's not all that solidity offers. There's a bit more that we can offer today, and it's a special one. It's called a structure. So what a structure is that it's full name data structure, but we call it by a shorthand struct. And so what a data structure is that it represents an item or an object that has characteristics or features that are sort of abstracted or contained. So that sounds kind of weird, and this is what an example structure looks like. So we have a structure, and we call it an object, and so we have a characteristic and an owner and then a bunch of other stuff that we can use possibly. So again, this sounds kind of weird, comes off kind of complex and everything, but I'm gonna try and simplify the best I can for you guys. So you can think of it like this. We have just a person, right? And just like anything else, this person has attributes. So can we think of any attributes that this person has?
Arms.
Legs.
Ears.
That's correct.
Facial hair.
Okay. Anything else?
Clothes, feet,
shirts,
shoes.
All right. Those are all like great characteristics. It's true. So yeah, we have this person, he has characteristics. So we can think of his head, he has a rectangular head, in my opinion. This is how I think. But yeah, so the characteristic of his head is that it's rectangular, right? So another characteristic is that the number of fingers that he has per hand is 5. Another characteristic is that his hair is black. And then another characteristic is that he has 2 feet, so the number of feet that he has is 2. So those are simple characteristics of a human or any person that are pretty easy to define. So a structure is pretty similar to this. If this is a person, we were able to enumerate his characteristics. We can sort of define a structure, person, and sort of list these characteristics. So this is how you define a structure. You just have the keyword struct, the name of the struct. This will eventually turn into the type later in your program. And then an open and close curly brace. Any questions? Cool. So we have our structure. We define a structure called a person. So our person had an attribute called his hair, had an attribute called the number of fingers that he has. So with his hair, I defined it as a string because, I mean, his hair is black. The word black is a string of characters. As for number of fingers that he has, you can't have negative number of fingers. You can only have 0 or a positive number. So that's why it's an unsigned integer. So another attribute that our person can have is the type of head. So I defined it as rectangular, and the word rectangular is, again, a string of characters. So the data type of the attribute, head, is strings. And so a person can also have an attribute called number of feet. Again, you can't have a negative number of feet, you can only have 0 or a positive number, so that's why it's an unsigned integer again. Any questions while we're here? Cool. So we are able to define what a person is, but how do we create a person in our program and assign attributes to this person? So we need to sort of get, set, and edit these attributes for any person that we have or any structure that we have. So to create and make changes to any structures that we have, as for creation, like I said earlier, we have a structure called a person. And again, this person later in our program would be a type. So we have a type person later in our program, and we titled it Alice. So as we can see, this variable Alice is of type person, so Alice is a person. And so to edit her attributes, we say Alice dot any of the attributes, and then we set it equal to a value that has a type defined by the type in one of the characteristics. So if I want to say Alice has black hair, I say Alice dot hair is equal to black. And again, if I want to say how many fingers Alice has, I say Alice dot number of fingers equals 5, and so on and so forth. Any questions? No. So yeah, that was a quick overview of structures. If you would like to go over the voting contract, you can visit this link and I'll follow you in a few minutes. For those of you who just got in, this is a very short presentation, so I can go over it again if you like. Okay. Everybody that wants to visit this link, are you at this link or should I keep it up?
No, I keep it up for
you. Okay, cool.
Okay,
it's not connected for me either. Yes, I'm not connected to it though. Oh, my God.
link? Back to the secret fields that I was talking about in the presentation. If you did not know, when you have a Solidity contract in Ethereum, the compiler actually gives you, or the blockchain actually gives you secret variables that you can work with. So as I have here, what the Ethereum, when your contract is on the Ethereum blockchain and somebody's interacting with it, each time somebody interacts with it, in other words, sends it a transaction, the Ethereum gives you this secret or secret variable called message. And so essentially what message is that it's information about the transaction. And so really the only essential information that it gives you from there that's relevant for this course is the field called sender, which is the address of whoever sent the transaction or is trying to interact with your contract, and value, which is the amount of ether that the person is sending to your contract in that transaction, if they're sending any ether at all. Keep in mind that not every Ethereum transaction has to send value here and there, but every transaction just has to pay a transaction fee. So somebody can interact with your contract, and this value field and the message structure can still be zero. As a matter of fact, that happens most often. And so similarly, we also have the structure address, which is actually equal to the type address that we went over earlier. And the reason why it's structure is that not only does it store the address of, or really any address, but it also has a function called transfer. So if I have, say somebody interacted with this contract here, right? I can find out who sent it using this message.sender. And if my contract has enough ether, what I can do is that because it's an address, it falls under this structure address. And because this structure has a function called transfer, what I can do is that I can send ether back to whoever called my contract. Now that's just one use case, but essentially you can send money to any address you like as long as you have enough ether in your contract. And you do that by calling whatever address you have, dot transfer, and then any arbitrary amount of ether denominated in wei, which is sort of like a Ethereum cent. And so this last line right here would send one wei to an address. Does that make sense? Yeah, looking at the contract, I'll give you guys a hint and tell you that some structures would make this a bit more readable. We have all these mappings up here, and that's kind of confusing to a beginner. Does anybody have an idea of what kind of structure we can have? Maybe a structure for the candidate or for a voter? Any ideas?
Say that again, Joe.
So there are a lot of mappings right here. And that gets kind of confusing to some beginning programmers because it's just a lot of data that's not grouped together. But we can group data in a structure. Do you have an idea of what kind of structure we can use? Maybe a person or a candidate or a voter structure?
It's being called struct, voted or something?
Voted.
I don't know if that's what you would do, but I'm just saying somebody.
It's not
I don't know.
Yeah, it's an idea. Yeah, so typically you wouldn't have a structure for that. When I think of vote or voted, I would think of a Boolean value because you either did or you did not.
Right.
So for a structure, for one idea, if I can find my notes. Okay, here we go.
Does it say who voted in there?
Yes. So this mapping from an address to person voted, from an address to a Boolean, taking an address, say somebody who has voted, we can determine whether or not they voted from this mapping. So my idea is that we can have a structure for, say, a candidate, somebody who somebody else is voting for.
Yes.
So we can define that as a struct.
Okay.
candidate. And so now that we're inside our structure, we can add characteristics or members fields. So when we have a candidate, what are some attributes of a voting candidate? An idea that comes to my mind is how many people voted for them. So you can only have zero or a positive number. You can't have a negative number of votes. So I'm gonna call that an unsigned integer. And that's the amount of votes that they have. Anybody else have any other attributes that we should add to our candidate?
Party.
Party? What type should that be?
String.
Good idea. Anybody else? No? Okay, cool. So we'll leave that as is for now. Any other structure ideas? Maybe a voter? That sounds good. Alright, so we're gonna add a structure called a voter. So if I say struct voter, open and close curly brace, my cursor is in between, so I press return, and now I'm inside. So an attribute of a voter is their address. So if somebody needs an Ethereum address to vote because they need a wallet to send a transaction to interact with our contract. So, oh, that's kind of misleading, but I want to name this address, variable address. What else should I name it? ID? It's a good idea.
I had a question.
What's up?
You had the unsigned integer for votes.
Yeah.
Could we pull in that mapping from votes received into that structure?
That's a good idea. I'll say no for now, and okay. I'll get into why later.
Okay.
Any other attributes for a voter? I'll say whether or not they voted. Attributes? No? Okay. Seems good for now. So for our candidate, in this specific contract, as you can see, we have the name of a candidate. So for any candidate, I'm gonna have a string called the name. Does that make sense? I guess we can start in our constructor function, the function ballot, right here. Let's go line by line and make changes as we see fit. Actually, we can start off with these mappings. So, we have a mapping from an address to a Boolean that determines whether somebody voted, right? But we don't really need that because we have a voter structure right here. So what we can do is that we can have a mapping that sort of keeps a record of every voter out there. And so we can map an address to a voter. And we can call that mapping voters. And then that's relevant to a voter, but for candidates, we also have these mappings. Is valid candidate name and votes received, and these are all in, like, respective or relevant to our candidate, and they all accept an unsigned integer as a key. So this seems pretty repetitive because they all take the same type for the same reason. This unsigned integer will always be an ID in this contract. And because this Boolean and isValidCandidate is abstracted in our candidate structure, we also notice that this string and candidate name is abstracted in our string name as a characteristic of our candidate. And then again, same with this unsigned integer and votes received with the amount of votes that the candidate has. So what we can do is that we can replace is with the mapping from a candidate ID, which would be an unsigned integer again, straight to a candidate. And we'll just call that candidate, all lowercase. So, because we just deleted a few variables and we haven't made the changes to the rest of our contract, there might be a few errors at the bottom of your screen, but we'll ignore those for now. Any questions for the changes that we made so far? Okay, cool. And we also have, we forgot this mapping person voted, which we can take away because, again, in our voter structure, we have a Boolean that determines whether or not they voted. So we can remove that. We don't have to add anything else because we already have a structure that maps the address to our voters. Cool, cool. So, in this constructor function ballot, we accept a string candidate A and string candidate B. And the reason why we have those is because candidate A, in this case, will be the name of the candidate. And candidate B, in this case, will be the name of candidate B. They'll be strings for names. And so what we do is that we accept, we take candidate A and candidate B, and we store those string values into variables, candidate A name and candidate B name. And so because we have a candidate structure, we don't have to use individual variables each time. So, first, what we have to do is remove these, and we can create a candidate, two candidates actually. So we have candidate A, and we have candidate B. And so there's a naming conflict, and so I'll change names or the parameters of the function to arguments to the names. Does that make sense? So in the constructor, what I did is that I changed the name of each argument just to make them a bit more descriptive. They're strings because of the names of each candidate. And on the first two lines inside the constructor function, what I did is that I created two candidates, candidate A and candidate B, so far. So, again, we took their names, but we're not storing them yet. We created candidate A, we created candidate B, but we still haven't assigned their names yet. So what we can do is that we can take candidate A and candidate B and assign their name attributes to their arguments, candidate A name and candidate B name. So we can say candidate A dot name is equal to candidate A name. In the same way, do candidate B dot name equals candidate B name. So what we're doing is that we're taking candidate A and candidate B, and via this dot right here, we're going inside the structure into this name attribute, and we're setting it to the name. Does that make sense? Because we deleted the isValid candidate map, we don't need these next two lines anymore. isValid candidate, because that variable does not exist. And the same with these next two lines. And so because we have a map from candidate UINT to a candidate, called a candidate. I'm actually going to rename that because I say candidate way too many times for that to make sense. So what I'm going to call this is candidate by ID. now that I have this map from an unsigned integer to a candidate, this unsigned integer will always be an ID in this case. So I can use an ID of type unsigned integer, and it'll always map to a candidate. So because I have two candidates, candidate A and candidate B, what I can do is that at the top of the contract, we create these integers, candidate A ID and candidate B ID. So now what we can do is that we can say candidate by ID of candidate A is equal to candidate A. And so what this says is that now we're adding a new row in our 2D table, and we're saying the key is this ID, candidate A ID. And the value is candidate A. And the reason why it's doing a candidate A ID is because we're creating a map from the ID.